It's the end of February 2024, and we have a new version of After Effects packed with innovative features designed to enhance your productivity and expand your creative toolkit. Join me as I delve into these updates, exploring each one in detail. So the version that I'm referring to is 24.2 or higher. You can see the version that you have in the Creative Cloud app by going to the video section and then clicking on Learn More next to the AE icon, and here you'll see it. So anything above 24.2 will open up those new features, and the first one is native import of OBJ 3D models. So OBJ is almost like the PDF of 3D files. It was developed in the early 90s by Wavefront Technologies, and since it's an open format, it has been adopted by almost all 3D graphics applications vendors. We had access to it in the beta version of After Effects for a while, but now it's finally available with the official release. So you can now import those OBJ files and their associated materials, add them to your composition, animate and render them in the same 3D space as native After Effects cameras, lights, and other 3D layers. Let me show you how this works. So I have this composition here, and I want to add a 3D model. Let's go with the Nautilus. I'll pause the playback, I'll return to the project, I'll double click over here, and I have this OBJ file. And here on the Mac, you can also preview it from different directions. When you export your OBJ, make sure you have this MTL, the material files, as well as a folder with all the corresponding materials, which is critical to get all those things appearing correctly inside After Effects. For now, I'll select the Nautilus.obj and click Open to bring it into the project. I'll drag it to my comp in progress, and then I'll see the model setting dialog box. So I'll click on Make Comp Size, and I'll click OK. Now, to save some time, I already created this cruise line, and this is just a null object that I've animated in 3D space. So what I can do is select the submarine 3D model, hold down Shift, and using the pick whip from the parent and link column, I can shift parent it to the cruise line null object, which is now going to move using the same 3D coordinates. However, we do need to go to the properties panel and change the Y orientation. So the submarine is going to point at us. So maybe negative 90 degrees. And then if I'll press spacebar, we can see how this works. So it's going to behave similarly to GLB and GLTF, which are the previous 3D formats that we had inside After Effects. Now, what I did over here is I actually tried another model. You can see this is the yellow submarine. So I'll switch off the Nautilus, with all the respect to Captain Nemo, and I'll go with the Beatles version, which is this one. And of course, as per usual, you can also apply 3D effects to it if you are willing to use a solid layer. So let me just pause over here where we can see it. These are my 3D effects. I'll switch off the visibility of this yellow submarine, turn this layer on, and show you inside the effect controls that I'm using the CC Composite. I already demonstrated it in another tutorial. The link is down below. I'm matching the colors using the color link effect, and then I'm applying the vector blur, referencing, by the way, the 3D model. And this is going to create this nice distortion as if the submarine is submerged under the water. And on top of everything, I'm applying the turbulence displace. So if I'll go to the beginning and maximize the screen, this is how everything is merged together. Now, currently you can't import OBJ sequences. So if you have an animated OBJ that you exported from whatever 3D application that you are using, and you've got a sequence of OBJs, After Effects doesn't support it currently. Maybe this is a feature that will come in the future. Who knows? But now we are going to see the next one, which is also related to 3D, using OpenEXR image files to create realistic lighting. So we can now use .exr images files combined with the existing .hdr files to relight a 3D scene. I've created a full tutorial on image-based lighting, so make sure, if you want to learn more, there's a link down below, just under the like button. However, we can now take advantage of an EXR images, which are a bit more easier to create and also can be used as a 360-degree map for realistic lighting, reflections, and shadows in your 3D scenes. And to demonstrate how this works, I'm going to switch to a different composition. For now, I'm using the Draft 3D just to get an accelerated preview. So I'll press spacebar and show you what we have here. A few transportation models with a 3D text. I'll pause over here near the end. And I'll open up this folder where I have two files. One is .hdr, and then I also have an EXR image. So both of them are a floating point images. So up to now, we could only use these .hdr images, but now we can also use an EXR. So let me show you how this works. I'll bring both of them down to the composition panel and switch off the visibility. I'm going to select the environment light because this is the way you control those textures. And then I'll twirl down the light options. Instead of the default built-in light, I'll first use the HDR image, and this is going to completely transform the entire look and feel of this composition. And I can change the X and Y rotation, and this is going to have a huge impact of how I'm rendering the scene. So let's pause over here. But now I can also select a .exr file, which are a bit more common and easier files to control. So I can do the same thing. And just to show you the difference between those two files, I'll return back to zero and then I'll switch off Draft 3D, which is going to render now the shadows for the objects as well as cast shadows for everything over here. Now we can obviously go to the pop-up menu here under renderer options and improve the shadows quality. But for the sake of speed, I just want to show you something which is, again, a new thing. So I'm just going to move this X rotation until I'm happy with where the shadows are. I'll let After Effects catch up with me. And once I'm happy with the result, I can show you another new option, which is cast and accept shadows for individual 3D models. So you can now control how 3D objects interact with light and shadows in your compositions. And you can do it by configuring their cast and receive shadows properties. So to illustrate it, I'm going to select this vintage plane, and then I can open up its settings, and you can see under the compositing options, I have two new features. So I can go between only, which is just going to render the shadows themselves. And then I can switch it totally off if this is something that I don't want to cast shadows on top of other surfaces. And of course, I can also do the same for accept shadows. So just for the sake of this demonstration, I'm going to select this open book. And then you may think that if you'll double tap the letter A, AA in sequence, it will show you these properties. But AA for the advanced 3D renderer doesn't do anything. So you actually need to open it up and then open up the compositing options. And in this case, I'm just going to switch off accept shadows, or I'll click again to turn accept shadows on and switch cast shadows in this case to only. And this is going to make the book, the entire 3D object disappear and leave us only with the shadows that it casts. So more compositing options is always a good thing to create more realistic results. Oh, by the way, if you are enjoying this tutorial, please like this video and consider subscribing to the channel so you won't miss any of the new stuff that I post. And just to rub it in, I'm going to show you a quick animation to encourage you to do it. Looks cool, right? I got this template from GAL Toolkit for After Effects. This is an amazing package that runs in both After Effects and Premiere Pro as an extension and includes over 1300 effects, transitions, titles, overlays, and elements designed by the Premiere GAL team. Now, I plan to show you more in the future from this package, but for now, I'll use this example that I've chosen from the social media folder, number 12, if you want to use it yourself. And if you do, there is an affiliate link down below. Anyway, this comp is already set up as a template. So if I'll open up the Essential Graphics panel, you can see that it's ready to go. So I can use it here inside After Effects using the Essential Properties options, or if I want, I can export it as a Mograt to Premiere Pro, which will allow me to demonstrate that with After Effects 24.2 and higher, we can finally tick this box, which will include a video preview. I can now do this instead of this secret handshake workaround that I demonstrated a few months ago. So I'll choose to save it here on my local drive. I'll click OK. I'll go to the desktop and export this template just to show you what the big fuss is all about. I'll switch to Premiere Pro and I'll import the Mograt that I've just created using After Effects. I'll click Open. It will show up over here. And the big deal here is that we have an animated preview. So this means that I can now, of course, drag it over here to Premiere Pro. And I can continue to work with it. Again, the big deal here is that we have this preview option inside the Essential Graphics, so we don't need to guess. Now, I must stress that there's a ready-made GAL toolkit for Premiere Pro as well, so you don't need to go through After Effects and export this as a Mograt file. You already have it ready if you want. And again, there are links down below. Okay, so this brings us to the last thing that I want to show you, which is enhancements for the Sycor plugins effect. So since version 6.5 of After Effects, we have a package of more than 70 Sycor plugins. Their initial is CC, so this is the prefix. Now, these effects are spread around the application in different categories and offer tools for compositing, distortions, and simulations. And the last release of After Effects brings cool enhancements to some of my favorite effects from the Sycor plugin family. The first one is Particle World, and the second one is Environment, which are much faster now. And for the Starburst effect, we have a new shading controls. But the biggest update, to my opinion, is with CC Ball Action. The effect controls are rearranged in a more logical order, and we also got new controls such as displacement, shading, and coloring. Let me show you a quick demo. So this 3D terrain was created entirely using CC Ball Action. Well, actually, with a little bit of a help from two effects. So let me walk you through it. I'll switch off the visibility for the CC Ball Action and show you that I'm starting with just a basic fractal noise, which is not even moving. So these are my settings, small bumps, spline, and you can read the entire thing for yourself, so you can freeze the video if you want to. I'll close it up and then I'll show you that I've applied the CC Toner effect, again, another one from the Sycor category, and I've chosen the Pentatone options for the tones, modified few of the colors. And on top of this, I'm applying the CC Ball Action effect, which you can now see arranged in a more logical way. But the biggest difference here is this displace property. So right now I'm selecting the blue, but of course you can choose any of these settings. So you can go with brightness, which is going to give you this result. This is the RGB. By default, I think it's set to brightness, but since we are using the blue color, we can actually go back to the CC Toner effect. And if I'm going to change the color, you can see how the colors are affecting the 3D structure. Now, of course, you have some other settings such as the coloring. So I set mine to crisp. You can also go with medium as well as smooth, depending on what you want to achieve. But if this is not smooth enough for you, then go back to the project panel, hold down the Option key and click on this little guy, which is going to switch your project from 8-bit per channel to 16-bit per channel, or maybe even 32. And this is going to improve the resolution of this effect. And you can see how this is working. Now, again, I must stress that this is a 3D terrain. So it's actually using the 3D vanishing point of your After Effects camera. All right, I'll Option click twice to bring it back to 8-bit per channel. And show you two other examples. Here, I'm using two instances of the Ball Action effect, and sandwiched between them is this galaxy phone, which is picking up from this ripple effect. I'll pause the playback, I'll switch from my active camera to custom view one just to show you that everything here is true 3D and works with native 3D objects. In this case, I'm using, of course, the advanced 3D renderer. The last example that I have over here is using the ball action displace property as an adjustment layer. So I'll switch it off, and first I'll show you what I have here. So this is just my regular 2D logo. Let's just play it from the beginning. This is all done using masks and a simple text layer inside After Effects. But when I apply the CC ball action effect to an adjustment layer, and in this case, I'm feeding the saturation as my displace property, as well as animating the ball size and a little bit of scattering, so we'll have this nice 3D noise, I can create a really impressive 3D look, again, all using a single instance of the CC ball action effect. And since this is, again, using the camera control, I can still move the camera and everything is going to respond accordingly. So that's it. This is all I got for you this time around. I hope you can use it in your own work or maybe also during your holiday. Totally up to you. As always, thank you for sticking until the end, and I will catch you again in the next one.